Christi. Amen. And welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the Monastery, the open bar of the internet, the world's greatest shit show, and the place where we, the good brothers and sisters of this most holy of temples, seek enlightenment through the drunkest, craziest, and most batshit ways possible. I am your one and only gaming monk, better known as Mildra, and with me I have a newcomer to the temple, a longtime creator of RPGs ranging from the works of TSR to the works of West End Games, Artelsorian, and a handful of other companies, as well as a novelist. Lisa Smedman, how are you doing today?
Hello, welcome. Glad to be on your show. I'm doing well.
Thank you for coming in to the internet's open bar, and So it's a bit of a tradition around here, and I know a bit of this was gone into on your site, but I like to start at the humble beginnings. So, mm-hmm. walk me through your first introduction to role playing, as we all know it, and what about it was what made it stick with you?
Yeah, my introduction to role playing was back in college. A friend introduced me to D&D, and I played a game. Thoroughly loved it, even though the game went disastrously for my character. I played a hobbit, halfling. I managed to get turned to stone early in the adventure, and basically from that point kind of sat back and went, is there anything that can cure this? And he was like, oh yeah, yeah, don't worry, it'll you know, there is a way to fix it. But for the rest of the evening, my character became the battering ram. Everyone would pick it up and run at doors and smash them open with me. But despite that inauspicious beginning, I really enjoyed it. The next game, I abandoned the little halfling and created a wizard instead. And that game went much better. Although my wizard's persona was to always stop and brew up some tea and think deeply about life. So I was really into the role playing from day one. Mm-hmm. And then after those two games, I was hooked. I ran out and bought Dungeons & Dragons basic set, which was then that red box with
Beckme.
Yeah. And then immediately started to DM because I really enjoyed shaping the story, you know, running the game, sort of knowing what's going on behind the scenes and watching as the players threw me curveballs all the time. So yeah, that was the beginnings.
Yeah. Now the first one that you had handled when you joined up with TSR was the work on Dark Sun, and what I'm curious about was At that time, was working on Dark Sun something you had specifically asked for, or was it a case of you got assigned to work on a Dark Sun project?
Yeah, that was TSR's choice. They obviously needed somebody to do some Dark Sun material. I had first approached TSR not terribly long after I started playing D&D with some submissions for Dragon Magazine. And these were essentially rules, tweaks, and thoughts on the game. Kind of the equivalent to, modding a video game, really. Like, mm-hmm. here's my house rules. What do you think? And they were really impressed with those. So they just called me up out of the blue and they said, hey, do you want to do, you know, something a little bit longer? Yeah, they gave me, first of all, a piece of a module, right? I was doing some wilderness adventures for a Dark Sun product, and they liked that. So they just started giving me assignment after assignment, and I wound up doing a lot of Dark Sun, a lot of Ravenloft, over the years, just whichever project mm-hmm. they gave me next.
Now, a good chunk of the output that you did during the TSR run was with Ravenloft. Mm-hmm. And I'm curious about was that a case of assignment, or what, or was there something within Ravenloft that stuck with you?
It was a case of assignment, but I really enjoyed the gothic flavor of it, and the fact that the world was literally a stitched together bunch of kingdoms, each one of which could be radically different from the next. Mm-hmm. So no two scenarios were ever the same in terms of either content or style, right? I mean, they were all dark horror. And I had a lot of fun with that one. I ran out to my local used bookstore and bought a whole bunch of collections of poetry from the 1800s and cracked those books open and was going through them. And I like to include a little bit of dark, gloomy poetry at the beginning of each of my scenarios. But yeah, that one was a lot of fun. It was very wide ranging, very, as I say, different. Every project was really different.
Now, when it came, your first, and I've actually put this as the image because I could, because I was trying to find a high quality image for Dragon's Crown and I couldn't, or the ones that I was able to find were all scans, and I didn't feel like breaking out my own scanner.
Right.
But when it came to Castles Forlorn, now if I recall correctly, that was your first full on box set deal.
Yeah, that was a big project and just a ton of fun. As I say, I'd been doing smaller pieces of this and that before that. But Castles Forlorn, I really got to go to town with. And I deliberately gave that one a very Scottish flavor. We've got monsters running around and throwing the caber and blowing bagpipes and that sort of thing. But what made that one really fun was that the player is really bouncing around in time, and it's multiple castles together, hence the castles plural in the title. So you might meet someone who was alive in one version of the castle and who was a ghost in another version of the castle and who had yet to be born or was a little kid in, a third version of the castle. And the trick for the players was figuring out, where the heck are we and who are these people and what's going on and how does it all interconnect?
Mm-hmm. Now what I'm curious about is up to that point, you said you had mostly done smaller stuff, relatively speaking. Mm-hmm. How much of a leap was it to go from that to doing a full box set or doing a full source book? Was it a challenge to adapt to that amount of space?
The only challenge would have been just finding the time to do the work. During my career, in addition to designing RPGs, I also worked as a reporter. Mm-hmm. And so I would kind of seesaw back and forth. Sometimes I'd be full-time as a reporter and just doing games on the side, and other times doing games full-time. I really welcomed the opportunity to really stretch my legs and just go for it and create a entire, an entire kingdom, really, with, all the details of the world and the people in it and the adventures, and super fun.
Mm-hmm. So when it came to the stuff beyond TSR,
mm-hmm.
Now one that I definitely am curious about is your time working with West End Games.
Mm-hmm.
And I will freely admit that part of that has to do with the fact that it was only a couple of years ago that I did a retrospective on these different Star Wars RPGs over the years, including the old D6 game.
Right.
So now you had worked on some stuff with Shatterzone, with Indiana Jones, and with Star Wars. Could you go into your experiences working with each?
That's a long time ago. I didn't work nearly as extensively with West End Games as I did with TSR. TSR was pretty much I'd complete a project and I'd say, okay, what's next? And I'd get another project almost immediately. I hooked into West End Games and other companies through another RPG designer, Nigel Findlay, who was a mentor for many people in Vancouver and was really good at networking people. So he kind of opened the door for many of us here in Vancouver who were designing at the time, mm-hmm. and introduced us to the people who were doing the hiring. And so that was how I became connected with West End Games. But as I say, I didn't have, you know, as direct a relationship with them. I've always done my design work at a distance, freelance. So with TSR, you know, I used to go to Gen Con each year and, you know, go to visit the folks at TSR and see the interior of the building and, you know, get to meet everybody. West End Games, it was very much more at a distance.
All right. I can definitely see that. Now, one part of the reason I asked when it came to West End Games, it is in some way related to a longstanding story that's been bandied about with them. That mm-hmm. when it came to their relationship with Lucas, and specifically the relationship when the Thrawn books were being written, that Lucas books had a bunch of the Star Wars books sent to the author as research. When it came to, was there any sort of research support that you had when it came to working on Star Wars and Indiana Jones? I realize that would be a bit trickier with Shatterzone because that was a independent IP.
It was not so much research into the universe as a whole, but just kind of sorting out how the work I was doing fit into the game system. So for example, when I was designing the aliens, I pretty much had free reign. They were just, you know, give us some aliens. Okay, cool. That's fun. You know, anything I designed would have been sort of subject to approval from West End Games, who presumably, although, you know, I wasn't on the inside track with this, who presumably would then, you know, clear it with the holders of the IP. My sort of level was just dealing with the people who would give me my assignments.
Mm-hmm. And now one of the other names that I saw in here that was, there were three other names that kind of surprised me in the list. And I will admit part of it is some of these I already had. It's just at that time I was a lot younger and I wasn't really looking through the names at the same level of detail I do now. Mm-hmm. But there was the stuff with Cyberpunk.
Mm-hmm.
And would it be fair of me to guess that part of the reason that deal ended up working out was because of your background as a reporter?
Yeah, that was something that I had pitched to them just because I worked as a reporter and I really wanted to do an adventure where the entire emphasis was on the things that would concern a reporter. Can we get somebody to speak on the record? Can we get footage of them? You know, can we get them to spill what they know, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I was intrigued by the technology of Cyberpunk, which is, you know, getting closer and closer to what we have today, actually, but as envisioned in the 1990s. And I'm a huge fan of Cyberpunk anyways. I love, you know, anything in a dark, gritty future. I remember contacting them because Cyberpunk was a system that I had picked up the rules books for at Gen Con one year.
Mm-hmm.
And basically read through the book on the plane ride home and was just so impressed with the system. Super impressed with the life path portion of the system where you generate your character's backstory in real, you know, vivid detail. Super impressed with the way combat is handled. Just really loved it as a game. And, you know, so approached them and said, hey, you know, can I do this design work for you? And managed to get that job as a result.
Mm-hmm. Now, I'd like to segue a bit when it comes to that, because something that I could easily see happening, and I'm speaking from my own experiences, on this as far as my own table is I think a lot of people construe reporter and journalist as if they're the same thing. And could you, given your perspective, could you go into the difference between the two? Because that's something that if someone were to pick up Live and Direct, I could see them making the same mistake that people at my table did.
Yeah. Just to be clear, my career path was working as a reporter for a newspaper, so mm-hmm. print medium. These days, I mean, journalist is broader than that, obviously. And certainly, you know, we've seen the role of journalists evolve quite dramatically since, you know, the 1990s when I was doing the cyberpunk work. You know, we now have a selection of sources of information that are presented in much the same way a journalist would present things, but not necessarily prepared by a journalist. So there's this wonderful explosion of content by people who aren't, you know, formally trained in the process of doing an interview and writing, you know, as impartial as you can be, writing an impartial story or creating an impartial story. You know, that was something that Live and Direct was sort of nudging upon, journalist characters who were formally trained, but there could be a lot of gathering of information because people have got, you know, cybernetic cameras in their eyes and so on, by just ordinary people. Right. And certainly we're seeing that today, you know, the equivalent today is everybody's got a cell phone. Everybody, you know, turns it on when an event is happening and suddenly we've got instant news, you know. So a lot has changed since that particular product was released in the real world.
Mm-hmm. So now taking that into account, you had worked on on Boomtowns for Deadlands, which mm-hmm. makes this a bit of fortuitous timing, since Deadlands is gearing up for a re-release with the upcoming, with the release of Savage Worlds Adventure Edition. Mm-hmm. Now Deadlands is getting a bit of catch up.
Right.
So, what was it like working with the what's now known as the classic take on Deadlands?
Oh, again, you know, Deadlands was a game I picked up for the setting, which is wonderful, rich setting. Mm-hmm. You know, Wild West meets horror, super cool. What I loved about that system is there was an instant recognition in the players if you were setting a scene as a dungeon master. You could just say, oh, well, you walk into a Western saloon. Everyone knows what that looks like, right? Mm-hmm. And everyone has their image of the Wild West. But then superimposed upon that, this really cool system of people coming back from the dead and magic and horrific things happening. So again, Deadlands, like Cyberpunk, was a gaming system that I was really captivated with. I loved the idea of you know, the different types of dice representing your skills, right? You know, were you just a D4 in something or were you, you know, a D10 in something? Mm-hmm. I loved the whole system that they had of hands of poker, literally having a deck of cards and, you know, playing a hand of poker with the devil to get your spells. That was thematically super cool. And system-wise, it was a really interesting mechanic. And most of all, from Deadlands, I loved the system where if you played in character, if you played one of your hindrances, one of the things that would trip you up as a character, one of your flaws or weaknesses, if you played that, you would get a poker chip from the DM. And then later in the game, you could spend that poker chip, you know, to improve your rolls and so on. So I thought that that was one of the first games I had encountered that really strongly encouraged players playing in character, even if it wasn't the most beneficial thing, you know, for your group. Well, I'm greedy, so I steal it. No, everyone is saying, you know, but no, I'm in character. You know, other systems had done something similar. GURPS had done something similar with its system where you have, you know, pros and cons about your character, and that ties into the system. But they didn't do it in quite the same way, with that motivational carrot of, you know, a token that you would get, the poker chip that you could then spend, right? And I thought that added just a ton of depth to it. So in over my career, time and again, I've encountered a particular gaming product that I've really, really enjoyed, and I've just gone, oh, this blew me away. I want to design for this, right? And most recently, that happened when I discovered Gloomhaven, the big box board game. And I started playing that about a year ago, immediately was captivated by it. I've been playing it nonstop for over a year, ignoring many of the other games in my tabletop collection, and there are many, many games in my collection. And then, you know, a few months into that, I thought, yeah, this is really good. And actually approached Isaac Childress and said, hey, can I design for you? Can I write stories for you? I think your world is really cool. Your game is really cool. And he said yes. And he has, of course, he's in the middle right now of his Frosthaven Kickstarter. And so he just announced on Saturday that I'm going to be one of the guest designers, as he calls them. So I'll be doing a series of scenarios for the new Frosthaven product that will be coming out, I think, sometime next year. So this is one of the wonderful things about the tabletop industry, about the RPG tabletop industry particularly, is that it's possible still at a convention to just, you know, walk up to somebody who owns a company and say, hey, I love your game. Can I do some work for you? Whereas in what I have found in the video game industry in comparison, you know, if you're trying to approach them, they don't want to see you in person. They want you to, you know, send them your resume at arm's length, you know, and maybe get a Skype interview. But it's not just like the video game industry at all. I mean, we're talking, you know, huge AAA studios there, right? That probably get flooded with requests. But I have found over the years that, you know, for example, when TSR got sold to Wizards of the Coast, or purchased by Wizards of the Coast, Wizards of the Coast was super small at that point in time. And you could walk right up to the CEO at a convention and say, hey, you know, I want to do some work. And that does remain possible for quite a few of the companies that are still producing tabletop RPGs. They're very approachable, right?
I've had a handful of people in tabletop on this show, so I think that should speak volumes about the whole approachability thing. When it comes to that, with a lot of the ones that you've mentioned, there has been the emphasis on the narrative that those particular games bring, and this brings me to a new form of the age old role versus role debate,
right?
And what I'm curious about is, do you lean a little bit more in the narrative and the story end of things, because some people lean that way, some people lean the mechanic end. Some people, like myself, are stuck right in the middle, saying both sides are going, saying if you've gone too far to the left or gone too far to the right, you've gone too far. What's your take on that whole situation?
Well, I'm sure no surprise, given that I write novels for a living also, narrative, very focused on narrative. Mm-hmm. But, you know, with that one exception, well, more than one exception, but, you know, with certain exceptions, let's say like Gloomhaven, that are much more about the system and the combat and the dice, not dice rolling because they don't have dice, but the card play. Mm-hmm. But yeah, definitely games that allow a story, a really rich story, to be told with a certain degree of randomness to the direction the story can go, so dice rolling. A really, my preference is certainly a really streamlined combat system, right? If I'm in it to be a role-playing game, I want the combat to be as clean and as quick as possible. Classic D&D, obviously I love it. I designed for it for many years. But when we hit the combat section, now we're going to be sitting and rolling dice for a half hour, for an hour, to resolve what's maybe, a minute of combat in the game time. And so I've been quite captivated lately with systems and smaller RPG products like one that I particularly enjoyed was Tales from the Loop. And mm-hmm. in this system, each person who's got a character describes roughly what their character is doing during the action scene. I'm going to run over here, and then I'm going to throw this out the window, and then I'm going to try and punch the monster in the nose, and whatever you're doing. And then at the same time, everybody picks up their dice and rolls a pool of dice, and you count up the number of successes. And it's like, yep, you as a group succeeded or failed. Right. And the DM adjudicates, on degrees of success or failure. Mm-hmm. And if you haven't quite succeeded, but you're close, there are some little extra things you can do. Your character takes a wound or, something. And you describe it in very cinematic terms. And then the DM will say, OK, add a couple more dice. And you roll those couple more dice and you hope like heck that you've reached that tipping point where the actions that you're describing are going to succeed. So something like that, where, the emphasis is on the cinematic moment and what people's characters are doing rather than, a long series of dice rolls where, hit points are being nibbled down bit by bit. So I really enjoy that one. I also really enjoy the Fate system. Mm-hmm. With its very streamlined, pick up a bunch of dice with pluses and minuses on them, roll them, count up the number of results. Boom, you've got an answer right there, and you've got your degree of success right there as well. So a really clean system, a really fast system. That's one that I've run for kids a lot of the time, because it's even very young kids, it's very quick for them to tell me, okay, how many pluses and minuses? Okay, here's what happens.
Now, it's funny you bring up the Tales from the Loop, in part because that's getting a live action series soon.
Yeah.
But I recently covered a game that uses the same system, because Tales from the Loop uses the Year Zero engine.
Okay. Yeah, I haven't played Year Zero.
It started with Mutant Year Zero, or originally just Mutant, when it was still only available in Sweden. But that system is used by a few other games. Most recently, Alien.
Mm-hmm.
Which makes that the first time in almost 20 years that somebody has used the Alien IP for role-playing.
Mm. Yeah.
Mostly because the last time was the Aliens Adventure game, and that used the same system as Phoenix Command.
Mm-hmm.
And no disrespect to the people who did that system, but it's too much crunch. Too many charts.
Yeah.
The thing that I always find kind of funny with the arguments that insist on that hyper detailed level of combat, especially from a lot of the old school D&D adherents, is they almost always have a background in wargaming.
Mm.
And would it be fair of me to say that you do not have that background?
Oh, I do. I do have that background. I started tabletop minis wargaming, back when I was in elementary school. I don't even know how old I would have been. And, you know, went out and spent all my allowance on miniatures and little tanks. And I used to play with a neighbor next door, and we would, for our terrain, we would stack up books and then throw a blanket over them. And those were our hills that our little tanks drove over. And I'm a member of Trumpeter Tabletop Game Society, and which here in Vancouver, which meets on a monthly basis. And I've done a fair bit of design work on tabletop minis games, not for other people, but just my own, you know, take on that. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, I'm, and it's funny that you brought that up, because while I, you know, for RPGs, I really want the narrative. But I'm equally enamored of, some really quite complex, tabletop minis, tabletop combat systems. I've played just a, I've more miniatures painted and unpainted, awaiting painting, than I could even count.
At the very least, I wouldn't have to yell at you for the same thing I've had to yell at some of my students for. Thin your paints.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
I've seen what happens when it doesn't, and I'm pretty sure anybody who is not thinning their paints should probably be on trial for war crimes.
Yeah. Yeah, of course, I don't paint as well as I used to, you know, with the glasses. I need bright sunlight now, but my close-in vision is not what it used to be.
Yeah.
But I still enjoy painting minis. I'm looking at my table right now, and I've got a host of 28mm Africans sitting there waiting to be painted for the Congo game, which is much more rules light than some of the systems I play. Another game I really enjoy, tabletop minis, is Force on Force. And at a convention last year, I actually recreated the entire narrative of Generation Kill using Force on Force. So I went and bought a bunch of Humvees, 15mm Humvees, mm-hmm. and wrote all my own scenarios, unofficially, of course.
Yeah. Now I will take the L on that. It's a bit of a habit of mine to establish patterns. Mm-hmm. But when it came, beyond that whole approach, I will admit if at the way I was going with that, I was going to pivot to joking that I wouldn't see you running Rollmaster anytime soon, or running Harn.
Yeah, yeah. I'm familiar with those systems, but no, I've never run them.
If it helps any, Rollmaster was the same system that was used for Middle Earth role playing.
Mm. Mm-hmm.
Even if MERP was a bit of a simpler version.
Mm-hmm.
And you can't see it, but I'm using the biggest finger quotes I possibly can by saying simpler.
Yeah.
Because Rollmaster kind of pioneered the whole idea of critical hit location effects.
Mm-hmm.
But that also meant charts.
Yeah.
Lots of charts.
Yeah. You'll notice that I designed for a game, an RPG game called Millennium's End. Mm-hmm. And that one was trying to be current day and very realistic in terms of its depiction of weapons and wounds and so on. And that game actually came with a series of templates with little dots on them, human figures with little dots on them. And then you would roll to see exactly where on the body you had hit your target. a bit of work, just a little bit more work than a lot of the games that I really took to, but I did enjoy designing for it. And I together with a couple of other people collaborated on a source book for that system that was about terrorism, and this was long before 9/11, right? Mm-hmm. So it was a little bit ironic to be, you know, watching the events of 9/11 unfold and going, I remember about terrorists back in the day, and I didn't see that one coming. So, yeah.
With all the systems that you've mentioned now, before I get into this, I will give a bit of background to kind of understand the method behind this particular madness.
Sure.
Not too long ago, I had Stephen Long on, and not only that, but Graham Davis, and in both cases they had talked a bit about just adapting to different rule sets than what they were used to. Was there any situation that you had where you had to spend some extra time getting yourself acclimated to the rule set of a certain game because it was so off from what you had worked with beforehand?
Yeah, it's interesting that you say it because I've just worked with so many systems, and there's always that learning curve, right, to come up to speed with how does this one do it? You know, both in terms of lore and in terms of system. But I still find that when I'm running games, what always trips me up is I have a gist of the system that I'm running, no problem, but I'll start using terminology from another system and I'll go, okay, make your observe roll. No, it's not called that. Make your look around roll. I don't know, make your notice roll, make your spot hidden roll. What is it in the system? so there's that. The terminology gets all jumbled up sometimes. And I'm just like, okay, whatever the role is in the system for you noticing something, make that role now. So I've run systems that have great long lists of skills and other systems that are just like, you know, it's a physical skill. Roll your physical dice. It's a mental skill. Roll your mental dice. So from one extreme to the other in that regard. But there's always, I've gotten quite proficient at coming up to speed with someone's IP. Both, as I say, in terms of the system and in terms of the world, writing novels, there's just so much more that you're bringing to the table there. And maybe it fits with the canon, maybe it doesn't. I can remember when I was first writing novels for Forgotten Realms, and Philip Athens, the editor I was working with at the time, I would constantly be having continuity questions, right? Like, is this, who is this person? Who's that person? How can you tell me more about them? Because I was including them in my stories. And he just laughed and he said, well, there's three of us here at TSR who more or less know the Forgotten Realms, and we're it, because I was saying, is there a story Bible somewhere or a world Bible somewhere? Bible being a term for, the collected wisdom. It would be the equivalent of a wiki today.
Yeah.
He just shook his head and he said, no, it's in my head and it's in two other people's heads. And there's just so much. I mean, at that time, if you took all the Forgotten Realms novels that had been created and stacked them all up, they'd be, maybe as tall as you, right? So
I think somebody at one of the bookstores I used to frequent in my old neighborhood did that I think they did it just to mess with me because of the fact that everybody knew I was banging my head on the exit sign every time.
Yeah, yeah. So, I mean, there was just no way as an author that I could ever, I suppose I could have read all those books, but I mean, it would have been counterproductive. I would have spent more time reading them than I'd spent, writing my own novel. I would just be constantly going back and, okay, tell me about this, tell me about that, what's going on. And what was often fun about writing those novels is that I would know, before the public knew, all the details of the next edition of D&D that was coming out. So when they transitioned from 3.5 to 4, they did create a whole, Bible for the world that explained how the world was changing and who the characters were. And I knew well in advance, you know, which characters and gods were going to be killed off, but I couldn't say anything. I had signed an NDA, non-disclosure agreement, that I would not say anything. And so I kept my word and kept quiet, zipped it up and kept the big secret until, you know, that edition launched and my novels came out.
Now, when it comes to that, something that I find very, very interesting, because this is something that's been a bit of a, for lack of a better term, annoyance with D&D for years, is the whole half in, half out, does it have a default setting, does it not have a default setting kind of thing.
Oh, yeah.
So when you say that that there wasn't that kind of Bible when you were working with Forgotten Realms, that helps put things in perspective on my end. Because
if you read through some of the Forgotten Realms novels and some of the Forgotten Realms products, you'll sometimes see a character's name spelled one way in a novel and a different way in a source book and a third way maybe somewhere else.
I had to negotiate many, many arguments about that.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
And I get the feeling that there was more than one situation where you had to walk up to somebody at either TSR or Wizards of the Coast and say and ask, did I spell this particular name right?
Yeah, I did that on more than one occasion. And what was even more amusing to me was as the books were translated into other languages. Sometimes I'd have the translator phone me up and say, how do you pronounce the name of this character? And I'd go, I don't know, because it was a character that, you know, was pre-established in the world. Mm-hmm. And I didn't even know how to pronounce their name. I knew how to spell it, but not necessarily how to pronounce it.
And, well, with some languages, you can get away with that, especially if they're some of the Western European ones.
Yeah, yeah.
The further east you go, the harder it is to get away with that.
Yeah.
And I'm not a linguist. It's just I happen to know enough about the various quirks that languages have, and the fact that every linguist I've ever met has told me English is weird.
Yeah.
But to that end, I'm curious about is. Is it more natural for you to write about fantasy or science fiction, or is there not that much of a jump?
I've always done both, and that was one of the joys of writing for Shadowrun, which I did as well. And Shadowrun, of course, being this crazy world where there's magic and there's people who've morphed into other races and there's high-tech cyberpunk stuff going on as well. Mm-hmm. And so Shadowrun was quite different. With Forgotten Realms, they'd usually say, we want a book set in a particular part of the realms or focusing on a particular character. And then it would be up to me to come up with what exactly that book was about. With Shadowrun, the instructions from FASA were basically, okay, give us another novel. Yeah, okay. Shadowrun allowed me the freedom to, if I felt like writing, you know, gritty cyberpunk, I could do it, right? If I felt like writing more something that was much more fantasy-based, I could do it, all within the context of the same world. But I do bounce back and forth between the two in my personal writing. I'm these days cutting out the middle person and self-publishing novels directly to Amazon. And one of my latest was a collaborative project that I did with some other writers that's, you know, hard science fiction, as scientifically accurate as, you know, is possible when you're doing speculative fiction. And that one is called Windship, the Crazy Plague. Mm-hmm. And that's set on a distant colony world with strange aliens. And human settlers who have been cut off from Earth for many decades. So very much on the hard science end of the spectrum. But really, you know, my writing has been, you know, science fiction, fantasy, murder mystery, and a lot of nonfiction as well. I'm a huge history buff, and I've published tabletop histories, big picture books of the history of Vancouver, my native city. And I also really like alternate history. Because I'm such a history nerd, I love going into, well, what if this had changed or that had changed? Writing alternative historical fiction as well.
When it comes to alternative historical fiction, I think that one was opened up with jumping into something like Deadlands, which starts off as alternative history. But
I did a my own take on something. It wasn't Deadlands, but it was a novel I wrote several years ago now called The Apparition Trail. And the premise there is it's set in the Canadian West in the 1800s. Magic has started working for the First Nations people and for the European settlers. Perpetual motion has started working. And it's the story of a Mountie who's out to solve a crime in this weird fantasy alternative history version of the Canadian West, using people as my characters in many instances who actually were historical figures, you know, First Nations leaders, actual commanders of the Mounties back then, and so on.
It's funny that you bring up something like that, since I've dabbled with alternative history. The biggest instance was one that I had done which unfortunately I wasn't able to finish because I lost the notes when my old computer went belly up.
Always have a hard drive separate. Yeah.
I did have a hard drive separate. It was a lightning hit.
Oh, okay. You're excused.
Yeah, I had a backup plan, but the problem is I didn't have a backup plan for my backup plan.
Yeah, yeah.
But it was rooted in the concept of what if Franz Ferdinand actually survived his assassination attempt and tried to create a United States of Austria-Hungary.
Mm-hmm.
The approach that I ended up going with was that World War II ended up happening. Mm-hmm. It ended up happening anyways, but the circumstances were different. Because the way I saw it, the situation in Europe at that time was a powder keg waiting to go.
Oh, yeah.
It's just a matter of what was going to set it off, and it just happened to be the assassination of Archduke Ferdinand.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And everything went like dominoes.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm a big World War I history nerd as well. Designed a couple of tabletop things that have to do with trench warfare, trench raids rather than trench warfare, because trench warfare wouldn't be terribly captivating as a game. You know, you get up out of the trenches, you die. Mm-hmm. Okay.
But the approach that I went with instead was a Austria-Hungary civil war.
Okay.
You've got one side that wanted to go with the more traditionalist approach that Franz's father had, one side that wanted to actually give the all 11 states that were within Austria-Hungary their own thing, many of them having out of country allies because of the whole way that allyship worked in Europe at that time. So it's the case of World War I event ends up happening, just happening under different circumstances.
Different way, yeah.
And it could be argued, well, isn't that redundant since you're still doing World War I? Yeah, but that's the only That's where it's still the war to end all wars, but that's where the similarities end. The thing of it is that when it comes to those approaches, I think alternate history will always be a fascinating little game. And I if I were to credit anything for that sort of approach, I'd probably credit Foundation, as odd as that sounds. There's been one little debate that I've seen happen with some of the authors I've brought on who deal with science fiction, and that is the issue of, as one person put it, large men with screwdrivers, i.e. science fiction that is all about people solving a problem instead of the characters in question.
Right.
Is that something that you had seen happen within science fiction when it came to what you were writing, or did you consciously avoid that?
Yeah, I've read and thoroughly enjoyed novels from both sides of the spectrum, novels that were all about the problem and the solution to the problem, and novels that were much more about people's reactions to the problem and their personalities and their relationships. So, you know, books with a lot of depth to the characters and books with, you realize, no, I could plug any widget in for this character and the story would proceed to pace. I deliberately try to come up with characters that are a little bit deeper and that... their particular background and motivation set and psychology informs how they approach the problem. And I find that, you know, from a writing perspective, much more interesting but that said, I'm always, you know, starting with the core that is science fiction, the what if, right, the speculative part of it. So I'm starting with that, and then I'm going, okay, we have this really interesting problem. Now, whose story is it, right? Who does it make sense to have as the protagonist? And then back up a step and spend a lot of time crafting that character, thinking about their backstory, thinking about their personality.
That definitely makes sense. Would you say it's easier or trickier to go from writing source books or box sets from RPGs to writing novels?
It's a slightly different skill set. Writing, let's say, adventures or source books, is very much about creating the framework and understanding for a story and understanding the way the system takes what you've written and interprets it. So there's still the same similarities in that, you know, you have to present characters as you know, being more than just cardboard walk-ons. You have to think about their motivations. You have to think about the setting and you know, craft a world in the same way that you would fiction. But fiction requires that extra step of being able to unfold a story in a particular way, to adopt a particular tone, to be much more creative about the craft of the story and how the tale is told. Whereas, you know, doing a source book is sort of like, you know, doing the frame for a house, right? Let's say, and, you know, here it is, now you finish it. If we're continuing that metaphor, writing fiction is like doing the interior decorating, right, as well, and being concerned about the mood and the ambiance, right? and how do we light our characters, you know?
Yeah, yeah, so, all that feng shui.
Yeah, exactly.
To that end, and this is another debate that I've heard both sides of the fence on for the longest time, and I've never really seen a right answer to this. I'd like to ask you a bit about the meta plot problem.
Okay. In what respect?
Now you've with several games that have come about over the years. Some of them are bigger offenders of this than others. Shadowrun can arguably be one of the larger offenders through its additions. But what I'm curious about is, what's your stance on an RPG having a kind of meta plot or a continuing story through its books?
Oh, I see you're getting at. Okay. And are we talking fiction, or are we talking about the game products there? Both.
It's a little of both, because oftentimes they have a yin yang relationship.
Mm-hmm.
This was especially the case with one of my pet favorites, Legend of the Five Rings, had this whole ongoing story for years until it got soft rebooted when Alderac sold it to Fantasy Flight Games.
So that kind of splits off in two directions for me. When I'm running an RPG, I have always adopted the practice of sort of stitching together little bits and pieces with a meta plot of sorts. You know, there's a thing that the heroes are trying to do in the world. But I find it much easier to keep that a little bit looser, a little bit less hands-on, and let the players shape that. And then, as I say, present little chunks of adventures for them, nice things that fit into a self-contained one-night, you know, scenario. There's just a whole learning curve involved when you're trying to, you know, assimilate into your brain in a gaming scenario all of this world and backstory and so on. I find if I create it myself, I'm much more likely to remember all the little details of it. So gaming, yeah, I'm much more, you know, I find a cool little adventure, and I've gotten super good over the years at just retrofitting that to make it fit. You know, it doesn't even have to be the same system. Just, you know, give me this little adventure as an idea, as a nugget I can build upon.
Kit bashing.
Total kit bashing. On the writing end of things, it's kind of like, I've done both. I've done novels set in gaming universes that are complete standalone. You know, none of the characters appear anywhere in the game products at all. I've obviously used the game and the IP as a starting point, but it's all original. To projects like War of the Spider Queen, where they said, okay, here are the protagonists you have to use, and it was, you know, six different authors, each writing a novel, each that had to tie directly, you know, wherever I left off, the next one had to start up. And when that one was being done, there was an overall structure to all of those novels that was really tightly designed to start with. So it was like, okay, Lisa, your particular novel is going to start here. It's going to end here. Here's your protagonist. They start off here. They have to geographically move through this section of the world. The following things have to happen somewhere en route. Off you go. So with that particular project was much more a paint within the lines project. And also a real challenge in terms of continuity, because the authors involved, we were all writing the novels more or less at the same time, you know, without the benefit of having a completed novel that was the one that came before ours, right, to refer to. So there was an awful lot of retrofitting of story, you know, as the novels in the chain were completed, and then suddenly it was like, oh, by the way, didn't we mention it? There's these extra protagonists you have to work in somehow, and I'm like, oh, okay. So, you know, fortunately, not only am I really, really good at ad-libbing when I'm DMing something, but I'm also pretty quick to go, oh, okay, this has to fit in. Yeah, we'll figure that out, right?
Mm-hmm. Now, you had mentioned the whole thing with multiple writers. Mm. Would it be in those kind of situations? Would it be fair? Was there any sort of cross communication between you and the other writers to make sure things were consistent?
Oh yeah, definitely. And between each of us and the editor who was stick handling the entire project. The thing is though that you're sort of in a flow and you're writing and you're doing, you know, you're not necessarily, it wasn't like today where, you know, people are hanging out on Discord as they're working on things, which is the case with some of my current projects, right? I'm involved in a couple of groups doing choose your own adventure style products, mm-hmm. and for game jams. And, you know, we're just constantly on Discord, hanging out, chatting. Every couple of seconds, there's a, you know, a new text message or somebody's posting a picture. You know, so really super easy these days to do that sort of really close, instant collaboration with other creators. Whereas, you know, back when War of the Spider Queen was written, it was, you know, yeah, we could send an email and maybe in a day or two we'd get a response.
Which was there only one editor when it came to that collaboration, or were there multiple editors? Because
there were multiple people involved. There was one editor that we all worked with, who was doing the actual, you know, copy editing of the pieces. But there was, because that was the whole shift over to fourth edition, there was a whole bunch of, and that was the other layer of continuity, of course. Whatever we wrote had to jive with the changes they were making to the world and their design. And, you know, even though there was a quite comprehensive Bible for that project, you know, things would change as the design process went along. So it, you know, it can be a bit unwieldy in that regard to try and, you know, completely change editions. So there's all the system changes. And what I found as an author was more times I was so familiar with 3.5, you know, I could rattle off all the spells and I'd be writing along and I'm like, okay, my character's a cleric or a wizard, whatever they are. And they do this spell. And so I describe it narratively and its effects and how cool it was. And, you know, then I'd refer back to, you know, what was happening in fourth edition. I go, that spell is gone. Oh, you know, and there would go a scene or a solution that I'd hope to include in a solution to a problem in the novel for the characters that I'd hope to solve, you know, with that particular spell. Yeah, so, you know, the double difficulty of not only keeping up with the IP and the way the story was changing and the world physically was changing in that big shift, but also the system was changing and parts of the system that were tried and true, you know, fallbacks for me that were the more interesting spells in many cases that I love to describe in fiction because they were just so wonderfully cinematic. You could imagine what they would look like or sound like or smell like, you know, were gone. And I was like, oh, okay, have to find a workaround.
All right, that definitely makes a fair bit of sense. And when you mentioned one editor, I just had this mental image of somebody, figuratively speaking, spinning plates with three or four people coming in.
Yeah, there would have been a whole design team working behind the scenes. He was just the you know, the contact person for that particular book project.
Yeah. And it's funny you bring up fourth edition because that's one where I've been caught on the wrong side of many debates, because I was the one guy in the room who didn't throw the thing out with the bathwater. And yeah. I got my fair share of crap for that, to which I dispensed crap back because well, a lot of people who were bringing it up against me were using, in my opinion, very bad arguments. My favorite was the they turned D&D into an MMO thing.
Yeah, I heard that one a lot.
Which, as somebody who's done testing for a handful of different MMOs, the question I have to ask is, and two, it really doesn't. Like when I've a lot of people jumped on the MMO thing when World of Warcraft hit. I was on that bandwagon long before that because my introduction to MMOs was Ultima Online.
Oh yeah.
And then EverQuest and I spent more time on Star Wars Galaxies than is reasonably healthy. Until SOE screwed up Star Wars Galaxies through including the Jedi character build that apparently Ralph Koster was adamant about not doing until he was forced to.
Oh, I see.
His reasoning was that the Jedi would be seen as an alpha class. Which I can't really disagree. So when he relented, it's a case of, okay, I'll put it in, but I'm going to make it hard to actually be one. Which was a bandage because people figured it out eventually. But when I think about the kind of design motifs that are in a sandbox style MMO like Star Wars Galaxies or a theme park style MMO like World of Warcraft, and I think about the types of content that's in there, whether it be PvE or PvP, or the way raids are going to work, the way questing is going to work, the way in-game economy is going to work. And then I compare that with D&D 4th edition, it doesn't match up. My theory has always been that the whole they turned it into an MMO thing was one article that ended up getting taken out of context through the grapevine effect, and two, a lot of people being reactionary to the runaway success that World of Warcraft had, because that was, I want to say, 2008, and that was right when when World of Warcraft was at its peak, because Wrath of the Lich King had just come out that year, and that's, for a lot of people, that's the high point. That was always how I took it. And granted, I'm not saying 4th edition was perfect, but it's a case of overhate. When it came to editions, you mentioned the whole thing of thinking that you had a spell and losing it. Was that something that happened frequently, or was that only in a handful of situations?
No, I mean, most of the, D&D was the only system that really made radical changes like that during the time I was designing tabletop RPGs. And most of the other systems stayed pretty true to their roots. They might fine-tune a thing here or there, but there wasn't that super big shift in terms of world content or system design that I saw going from 3.5 to 4 with D&D.
All right, that definitely makes sense. Now, as a kind of capstone, and this is one of those two-parters, but what advice would you have for someone who's coming up when it comes to tabletop design or fiction writing?
Okay. Tabletop design specifically RPGs, or just, throwing it wide open, board games, card games, everything?
If you want to go with the wide net or the narrow net, I'll leave that one up to you.
Okay. I would just say sort of the same things. I also teach at a college students who want to go on to a career in the video game industry. And my advice to them is similar. Play as wide a variety of games as you can. Play genres that you normally wouldn't think of playing. Play, you know, themes that you normally wouldn't think of playing. You know, and same sort of advice to people who are hoping to get into tabletop design. Just play as many games as you can. And broaden your knowledge of systems and worlds and so on. And just get as well-rounded as you can, because often some of the really interesting design work comes as a result of somebody, to use that term we used earlier, you know, kitbashing, right? Mm-hmm. A little bit of this, a little bit of that. And you can come up with something that's really quite fresh that way. You know, I've even taken a look at things like the earliest For Pleasure tabletop miniature system was Little Wars by H.G. Wells back in 1913. Mm-hmm. And he had a real-time component to tabletop miniatures gaming. And I was just like, what? So, you know, just something that got left by the wayside. It's all turn-based, you know, these days. So you never know what, you know, intriguing little nugget you can find. And then in terms of fiction, you know, really, again, read as, you know, as broad a range as possible, not just science fiction, not just fantasy. Read everything. And look at how it's done, how it's crafted. And then I think one common mistake I see people make is jump in and figure they're going to write a novel as their first thing. No, I would say, you know, hone your craft. Do a whole bunch of short stories. That'll teach you to complete things at least. And I personally have been a member of a writer's group for many, many years now. You know, get involved with a good writer's group, somebody who's going to give you constructive feedback. Because, you know, to this day, you know, I've been writing for decades now. I've had, you know, over 20 books, novels published and more in the works. And to this day, there are things that my writer's group will see in my writing with an editor's eye, and they'll go, oh, no, no, you need to change this, or it would be better that way, that I've completely missed. So get, you know, get eyes on your project, get constructive criticism, get somebody who can say, who doesn't just go, oh, this is crap and it doesn't work, but who can tell you why it doesn't work and more importantly, how to fix it. Right. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, if you're hearing that from every person around the table, the same messages coming to you, you're like, yeah, I better change that. You know, but ultimately listen to your heart, right? And do what you believe is best for your own story, right? So if they're trying to replot it all on you, you know, go, you know, stick to your guns. And I mean, unless they're giving really constructive reasons why the plot you've got isn't going to work. So yeah, and don't be afraid to put your work out there in the world, you know? You know, some people are very shy. And if you're just writing for fun and you don't care if anyone reads it, sure, why not? But if you would actually like to have it published, to have people read it one day, put it out there into the world. And you know, don't be afraid of getting some feedback and listening to that feedback.
All right. I can definitely go with that. And it does kind of tie into something that I remember Paul Ashour once saying at a TED Talk a long time ago. The greatest innovations in the history of mankind were done by people who had no idea what they were doing.
But it's kind of like, you know, there's a certain amount of craft involved. If I'm going to do a painting, I should know a little bit about color theory, you know. If I'm going to do writing, I should know a little bit about, you know, how stories are constructed. If I'm going to do game design, I should know a little bit about systems.
And for what it's worth, she had further clarified that what she meant by that, because she freely admitted that she was being facetious saying that, is that is when it comes to there being a right and a wrong way to do a certain thing. And a lot of times when you're told that there's that ends up being in a space in your head.
Oh, I can totally see that. Yeah, you know, if somebody, you know, tells you, for example, that science fiction and Westerns will never go together, I mean, don't listen to them. Just go out and make Firefly, right? So.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
Now you're bringing up Firefly. Now you're cutting deep.
I'm a huge Firefly fan. Yeah, a friend of mine nagged me for weeks that I had to watch it, and finally he just went out and bought the DVDs and thrust them into my hand and said, "You must watch this." I'm like, "Okay, fine." And not for any particular resistance, just I was busy. And then I sat down and watched them all back to back and loved it. So,
did that include the movie?
Yes, and fortunately, I watched that last. Completely different tone. I enjoyed it for different reasons, you know, because it was trying to wrap things up. But it was somber compared to the series.
There were a few comics by Dark Horse, because of course it was Dark Horse. Because if an IP is getting adapted into comic book form, 9 times out of 10 it's Dark Horse doing it.
Yeah, true.
And I've got a good chunk of those, and the main reason I ended up grabbing those was to answer the one mystery that kept eluding me throughout the whole series. What the hell is Book's deal?
Oh yeah.
And I will admit I used some of the stuff to do my own take on a follow up, including having the operative go by the name Shepherd Iscariot, because I thought it was because I wanted to delude myself into thinking that I'm clever sometimes.
Mm-hmm. I played Firefly with my gaming group for quite a while and really enjoyed it. Super fun system.
I'll probably cover it eventually, but it's one of those things where I have to go through the clarification dance because of the fact that there are two Cortex Firefly games. Technically.
Oh, I see.
Yeah. There was the one that used classic Cortex, that was just called Serenity, and then there was the Firefly one that used Cortex Plus that released a few years ago.
Yeah, I'm talking about the Serenity system, and we had a ball with that one. My players actually managed to take down Nishka. I thought I'd put him in Impenetrable Fortress, but no. Took him down, and they were very proud of themselves for that.
Yeah, but with that said, I do want to sincerely thank you for taking the time out of your schedule to come onto the show, and doing this is always a lot of fun. And if at any time you see fit to come back to the open bar of the internet, well, you know where the door to the temple is. You just have to brave the wastes of time zone hell to do so.
Yeah. Well, thank you for having me. I've really enjoyed reminiscing and talking about some of the projects I've done over the years. It's been super fun.
Of course, a sincere thanks to everybody who takes the time to out of their schedule to watch this particular bout of insanity. And there's going to be more craziness coming down the line as well. But until then, on behalf of the good brothers present and not present, my name is Mildra. I am your gaming monk. Stay fucking frosty, everybody.